The most wonderful people in television are the ones that do the looking. That's you.
We hope you have enjoyed our little visit just half as much as we've enjoyed being here with you.
There's a remarkable number of dangling facts about Stephen Paddock's mass murder in Las Vegas, which the media have shown little inclination to investigate. It's almost as if they're worried that too much investigation will simply ruin it. For example, who was the woman shouting, "You're all going to die," right before the concert? Is any reporter interested in finding out? Probably a random crazy lady, but that's not typical pre-concert behavior. Why is it taking so long to find out if anyone else went into Paddock's hotel room since he checked in the previous Thursday to the shooting? We are perfectly prepared to accept that he was the only one who entered that room, but can we at least see the surveillance video? The sum total of the information we know about Mary Lou Danley, the woman who's been living with Paddock for years, is the following. She was out of the country at the time of the attack, and she's not involved. Paddock had apparently assembled an enormous arsenal of weapons. Did she know about it? Did he tell her why? Had his behavior changed recently? Why wasn't he with her on her trip? Had they broken up? And why did Paddock recently wire $100,000 to her Philippine account? Within hours of the first indictments in the Duke Lacrosse case, later all thrown out, the media was bristling with information about the players' parents, the homes they grew up in, the ritziness of their neighborhoods, and the tuition at their Catholic high schools. Doesn't any reporter want to ask Danley anything? Do we know yet why Paddock broke two windows? What were his recent winnings or losses at gambling? We don't know if any of this would change the basic narrative, but the media don't know either, and they seem strangely reluctant to ask. As Sherlock Holmes said, first you exclude the impossible, and whatever remains, however improbable, must be the truth. Mainstream media isn't doing the reporting that would allow us to exclude anything, and they wonder why conspiracy theories develop, and it is more than likely that this is a conspiracy. The media's idea of hard-hitting investigative reporting is to taunt gun owners and white men, making snarky political remarks as job number one of reporters. Apparently, it's also the new job description for late-night comics. As long as we're looking for jobs that Americans just won't do, maybe we could find some immigrants to tell jokes and report the news. The celebratory headlines often sound like this: America's white man problem. How America has silently accepted the rage of white men. The white privilege of the lone wolf shooter. And other headlines. While it's great that liberals have finally found a mass murder that they don't think can be defeated with a Je suis Charlie hashtag, they're either lying or they don't know what they're talking about. Blacks and Hispanics are extremely well represented as perpetrators of mass shootings. Muslims are overrepresented. And, surprisingly, even the usually law-abiding Asians more than hold their own. There was one characteristic of white men in abundant evidence at the Las Vegas massacre, however. They're awfully chivalrous, these white male country music fans. 22,000 people came under sustained, high-powered gunfire, and no one was stomped to death. Something you can't say for a Black Friday sale at a Long Island mall. At the Las Vegas concert, men died protecting women, using their bodies as shields and standing up in the middle of a hail of bullets to direct the women to safety. The New York Post reports that woman said she was running away and a couple of guys said, "Hey, come stand behind us," and boom, they went down. A victim, Heather Melton, described how she felt her husband, Sonny, being shot in the back fatally as he shielded her from the rain of bullets. Without many facts to go on, one general sweeping conclusion that we can make thus far is there's a reason why feminism didn't emerge from the country music scene.
I stopped at a roadhouse in Texas. It was a little place called Hamburg Dan. And I heard that old jukebox play a song about a truck driving.